यम शैवा समुपासते शिवैदि ब्रह्मेदि वेदांतिनो बौद्धा बुद्धैदि प्रमाणपटवः कर्तेति नैयायिकाः अर्हन् नित्यथ जैन शासनरताः कर्मेति मीमांसकाः सोयं वो विदधातु वांछितफलं त्रैलोक्यनाथो हरिः। सोयं वो विदधातु वांछितफलं त्रैलोक्यनाथो हरिः। मदीय हृदयाकाशे मदीय हृदयाकाशे सदानंदमयो गुरुः उदेतु सततं सम्यग् अज्ञानतिमिरारुणः। हरिः ओम, हरिः ओम, हरिः। As usual, we shall recite in chorus three times the auspicious monosyllable Om. हरिः ओम तत्स। जय गुरु, जय गुरु। ईश्वरः सर्वभूतानां,
ईश्वरः सर्वभूतानां
हृद्देशे अर्जुन तिष्ठति,
हृद्देशे अर्जुन तिष्ठति।
ईश्वरः सर्वभूतानां,
ईश्वरः सर्वभूतानां
हृद्देशे अर्जुन तिष्ठति,
हृद्देशे अर्जुन तिष्ठति।
तमेव शरणं गच्छ,
तमेव शरणं गच्छ
सर्वभावेन भारत,
सर्वभावेन भारत।
तमेव शरणं गच्छ,
तमेव शरणं गच्छ
सर्वभावेन भारत,
सर्वभावेन भारत।
This is the summary exhortation Krishna made looking at Arjuna at the end of the whole Kurukshetra dialogue. What does he say? Understand very clearly, God is seated in the heart of everyone. Therefore, you have to seek refuge under him. I would like to know what prevents you from accepting this statement and acting upon it. Are you afraid that God is present in your heart, or are you happy? Nobody has told you the other way around. It is like the blind leading the blind. Even if you have all along been told about God in some other manner, when the right manner is said, why should you not accept it? The wrong manner, you accept it long back. Suppose there is darkness in any part of the globe, or maybe in the room or in a cave. For millions of years it was dark. When we take a small lamp there, even a candle, the darkness vanishes. In the same manner, you may have had an ignorance or an imperfect knowledge about God. When the perfect knowledge is presented, you should accept it. That is why the dialogue between Krishna and Arjuna was recorded in an eternal manner by Vedavyasa. Otherwise, the dialogue could have been left for itself to disappear in the air. It did not take place. So whenever we see the scriptural statements, revelations, we simply have to take to them with a lot of sincerity, zeal and fervor. Nobody can stand in the way at all. There is no excuse. Now what I am afraid perhaps is that you are afraid to think of God being present in your heart because you will feel the mystery about me will be exposed. Otherwise there is no reason. Every one of you is interested in God. You are approaching Him, you want His grace, etc. Here is God present constantly in your heart. So you can get His favor at any point of time. Any point of time. Now we will recite that summary statement of Shvetashvatara Upanishad. Ego Devaha Sarvabhuteshu Gudhaha
Sarvabhuteshu Gudhaha
Sarvavyapi
Sarvavyapi
Sarvabhutantaratma
Sarvabhutantaratma
Karmadhyakshaha
Karmadhyakshaha
Sarvabhutadhivasaha
Sarvabhutadhivasaha
Sakshi Cheta
Sakshi Cheta
Kevalo Nirgunascha
Kevalo Nirgunascha
Sakshi Cheta
Sakshi Cheta
Kevalo Nirgunascha
Kevalo Nirgunascha.
I will tell you the lacuna in your thinking. Everyone who has spoken about God in the world has always spoken of Him as omnipresent. There are three adjectives for Him. He is described as omnipresent, omnipotent, and omniscient. These three words cannot be dissociated from God. Omnipresent means present everywhere. Omniscient means knowing everything and all. And omnipotent means powerful for everything. These are the three descriptions of God right from the beginning of creation. Now, every one of you who has got intelligence, you have studied from the primary class onwards. At least by the time you came to the higher secondary class, or at least the school leaving certificate in ancient times, that final examination in the 10th class, you should have started questioning. My dear mother, my dear father, you told me that God is omnipresent. If He is omnipresent, is He not present in my heart? You should have asked this question. Why did you not ask? Did you not know the meaning of the word present everywhere? Everywhere means present in my heart also. So is it not always better and easier to reach God, to approach Him in my heart rather than at a distant place? This question every one of you should have raised. That you did not raise it, I don't know what does it mean. You yourself will have to give me the answer for it. Sheer negligence, sheer inattention, sheer lethargy, sheer indifference, lack of astuteness, lack of sharpness, lack of the ability to apply reason and logic to whatever you think, speak and act. At the same time, we want to be rational everywhere in this world. How many advocates are there in the high courts, lower courts and the supreme courts? At least they should have raised this question. If God is present everywhere, is He not present in my heart? Can He not find Him closest to me in my heart? Is He not accessible more within me and He remains inaccessible else, everywhere else? So the only place where you can access God is in your own heart and nowhere else. Let us be very clear about it. This God is the Sakshi, the witness. Cheta, the consciousness. Kevalaha, lone, alone. Nirgunasya, devoid of all the qualities that we know of. Now, Yesterday I told you about what all happened to Parikshit. He went back to the palace. By the time he reached the palace, he was already very, very repentant. After all, it was in a fit of temper that he did this crime. Normally, he would not have done. Apparently, there was a conspiracy of even providence, so to say. Otherwise, the great Parikshit would not have condescended to the level of doing this kind of an indecent, greatly criminal act of putting a dead cobra on a sage, especially when he was absorbed in his meditation, sitting in his own hermitage. So the act started stinging him, pricking him. By the time, like a wildfire, the curse also reached the palace. Now he was wondering what should be done, what should be done, what should be done. After all, in a fit of temper, he did a crime. We generally have a proverb in Kerala, even elephant sometimes slips its foot. Similarly, the king also slipped, the great king, the emperor Parikshit. That was a folly, no doubt. That repentance, it was almost burning him. But he was wise enough and determined enough to redress that crime. This is the message of Srimad Bhagavatam. You cannot think of a greater crime committed by anybody. After all, the most innocent and harmless people are the hermits and ascetics of the world. In our country, there are quite a number of them in all generations. To think of harming him, doing anything like an injustice, to him, it is unimaginable. This kind of a crime he has done. So you can imagine the torment, the affliction, the inner torture that he was suffering from. At the same time, he decided that I would recompense, I would pay the penalty for it. I would like you to understand very clearly, the human mind has got the potential and power for committing a crime and also for redressing its effects. Is the message clear? After all, it is human to err. Any error can take place. And the crime can be of any magnitude, any size. Let it be anything. If I start narrating, it will be very repulsive even. I am not going to say. There are so many different crimes, types of crime committed by the human mind. There is no end of it. Unthinkable crimes are committed by it. In a fit of temper, it happens. Anything can happen. One day I was narrating to somebody. There was a Brahmin who was always given to Shiva Puja. Every day he was doing Shiva Puja in his house in a very ceremonial manner. Very few people will do it. But he was one of them who was doing it. As usual, he was doing the puja. He had a 12-year-old daughter. The mother had received the information that her mother is sick, so she wanted to go home. And the daughter said, I will also come along with you. The father said, no. Let mother go, you cannot go, you have classes to attend, etc., etc. And he started doing his puja. The time for the mother came and she started moving from the house. This girl disobediently started following. First of all, he said, don't go, I had already told you. So the girl denied and started going. You know, this wonderful father got up from the seat, took a big knife and cut her head. Can you imagine the human mind causing this kind of a treachery? He went to the police station. Can you imagine what he was doing is puja? Puja, the most virtuous and ennobling act. That was the time the mind victimized him with an anger. As a result of which, in a matter of moments, his own daughter was killed, cut into pieces. This is what happened. So there is no limit at all. The human mind has got the potential to commit any crime, any kind of a wrong. But understand, the same human mind has got the potential to redress it, to come out of it. This is the message of Srimad Bhagavatam. He decided. Earlier it was in a fit of temper. Now it was a rational, a philosophical, a spiritual, a well thought out decision. I am a great king who sits on the throne. I am supposed to know the pulsations of every citizen's heart remaining here. If I misbehave, Nobody is there to punish me. When the people misbehave, the king is there to punish. I have to punish myself. Nobody else is there. I am going to take up the well-heard but never seen great vow called Prayopavesha, fasting unto death. Fasting unto death means without taking water, without taking food, only breathing the air. Simply wait for your death, nothing else. You don't kill yourself, but you deny food and water to the system. Though Prayopavesha, he decided. The moment he decided and spoke about Prayopavesha as a recompense for what I have done, that news started spreading faster and wider. See, the crime he committed was totally subdued. Nobody spoke about it. Till then, it was reverberating in the palace. The moment he said, I am going to undertake Prayopavesha, and he declared that it started already the next moment or that very moment, that news also spread. And do you know the effect? Anybody and everybody who heard about his Prayopavesha, the great Parikshits, they have heard about it. In our Shastras it is mentioned. There are many things mentioned. One item is immolation. And that immolation is not pouring petrol or anything like that. Generally it is dying in slow fire. There are instances in our country where people have resorted to it as a punishment for themselves for the crime they committed. The self-immolation done by Divakara is a great student who was the best in his teacher's class. He was constantly being criticized by the teacher. One day he's lost all his temper and hope. I am doing my best. I am going to the Guru's house. It was all Gurugula. So they used to serve the Gurupadni, going to the forest, bringing firewood, cutting it, splitting it, looking after the cows, milking them, washing them, drawing water, sweeping, wiping, everything they were doing. The Gurupadni also had a great impression about this boy. It is not a legend, it is a fact. I will tell you how it becomes a fact. So one day he lost all hope and faith. He decided, I will kill my teacher. Are you following me? Divakara, he decided, I will kill my teacher today. He had access to everywhere in the house. So he took a big stone and he somehow rolled it up and kept it almost on something like a false ceiling, but false ceiling is very light. This is something like a wooden ceiling. It was there. He kept it where the teacher and the teacher's wife, both of them would be sleeping. He kept it ready to be dropped right on his head. And he also climbed there and stayed. It so happened that day, the Gurupadni initiated a conversation with her husband. My dear husband, every day you are scolding this boy so badly. I am not able to understand. Is he not a bright student? I am asking him to do many things. With a lot of sensitiveness and brightness, he was always listening to me doing. Without being asked, he would do. Such a sensitive and brilliant boy, how can he be different in his studies? So is he not studying well? So the guru said, you don't know. He is the topper in my class, the best student. But I am afraid he will become proud if I compliment him. So I am scolding him a little, only to avoid his becoming proud, he said. Nothing more was necessary for the poor Divakara. He understood his own folly. He removed the stone from there, got away. Next morning after his bath, he goes to the teacher, prostrates before him, touching his feet, stood up. My dear sir, I have a doubt, a question to ask. May I ask you? Yes. If a student attempted to kill the teacher, what is the recompense? What is the punishment? Then the teacher asked, why are you asking me this question? It is just a question, a doubt, an inquiry in my mind. Why are you asking me this? He did not say anything. I want to know, I want to get an answer. Throughout yesterday, this question was assailing me, so I want to get an answer. Then the teacher said, the answer is, dig a hole, make a hole, as much as the height of the person, remove all the earth, get inside it, fill it with husk, and set fire to it, and die in slow fire, he said. He prostrated again and said, I am the criminal and I am going to undergo the punishment. The teacher persuaded him, dissuaded him, not to do, not to do, not to do. After all, you know, they were wedded to morality and ethics. So the teacher pleaded a number of times before his disciple, his student, don't do it, don't do it. I am not minding it at all. I have condoned it. No atonement is necessary. I excuse you. Nothing has happened. After all, you did not do the crime. You only thought of it. Thank God that you have been saved. I also have been saved. So why would you do anything like that? My question was, if one attempted to kill the teacher, attempted, not succeeded, I have not said it, attempted to kill, what should be the punishment? And you have said this is the punishment. Please allow me. With a lot of tears, etc., you can imagine the emotional scene that followed. The child went back, exactly did what the teacher said. When he was getting slow fire from the pit, he started composing a poem called Shri Krishna Vilasaha. If I remember correct, Asti Shriya Satma Sumeru Nama Samasta Kalyana Nidhir Girindraha Vishwan Vishwan Nidam Tishtamanu Pravishya Svena Atmana Vishnu Rivorjitena. This is the first verse of Shri Krishna Vilasa. When I was in my school, in the 7th class, one particular canto of the Shri Krishna Vilasa was taught. It was the class text. Now this poem on Shri Krishna is not completed. Before that, he got fire in the tongue, in the neck region. So he stopped. So the co-students were copying whatever he was saying. The legend says that Kalidasa, the great poet, wanted to complete it. So he started taking it and wanted to write. Kalidasa was a very great poet, perhaps greater than Divakara even. Divakara accidentally became a poet, but Kalidasa was a cultured poet. So when Kalidasa attempted it, there was an impersonal voice saying, do not try to add plant and thread to a silken cloth. Don't attempt it. So it is not attempted, it's not completed. So this is not a legend, this is a fact. The story of Divakara. Now what I want to say is, our human mind is capable of instigating us to commit any kind of a crime. Any kind of a crime. And sometimes it can happen as in the case of Divakara. Now I have presented this story during my writing and I say that there was no necessity for Divakara to take to this step. You know, a sin is committed. Here, who is involved? Himself is involved and the teacher is involved. And the teacher tells him that it is not necessary. Mental punishment is the greatest punishment. Physical punishment is much lesser. It is only tamasic in level. So I excuse you, you also do paschattapa. For every sin, repentance is the greatest redress. Paschattapa. Paschattapa means tapa after committing the crime. That is the greatest recompense for any sin whatsoever. All other ritualistic, physical and other methods are far, far inferior. Far, far inferior. Another way of redressing all the crimes that you do, shall I tell you? Huh? What? Not many people are saying. Another way of resolving and redressing all the sins is by taking up sannyasa. If you take up sannyasa, all the sins are completely washed. Sannyasa is virtually speaking a death of the present person and the birth of a new person. It is a rebirth. So all the sins along with the virtues completely vanish at the time of taking up sannyasa. So it is something very, very great. So we have got such beautiful proven methods. Our scriptures are very great. Our cultural traditions are illustrious. They are unparalleled. They are distinguished. They are extremely famous. So it was a hurried and an immature act. There is no necessity at all. We should live and endure our life. Living alone, the first requirement is Atmanam Satatam Raksha. This is the Pramana. First of all, you preserve and protect your life. When you are living and you are protecting, all the sins that you have committed can be certainly redressed. But if you destroy your life, nothing can be done. So, Atmanam Satatam Raksha. This is the last word of our Dharma Shastra. So, there was a recompense for everything, everything. So, when Parikshit declared it, it started spreading like wildfire again, but it's a pleasant fire. So many people arrived in the scene. They have heard about Prayopavesha, but they have never seen, had an opportunity. So when they heard that Parikshit had himself resolved upon it, all of them wanted to see. They started rushing to the palace. The whole scene completely got drowned. Pandits, ascetics, scholars, old men, experienced people, so many people, all of them, leaders, thinkers, whatnot, all of them arrived in the scene. And jointly in chorus, they congratulated the great king for having done whatever he had done. He acknowledged their compliments and said, he was after all a great king. So many things are mentioned in Srimad Bhagavatam, but I will recite one or two verses so that you will know. What is my purpose? My purpose is to tell you that our mind has got potential and propensity to do any kind of a wrong. But our mind also has the potential, the majesty and the magnificence to redress all that and to relieve you and save you also. Do not lose faith in your mind. Do not lose your hope in this world. Let the whole world be destroyed. Even then, let us not lose our life. Preserve it. After all, it is God's amsha, a particle in the ordinary language that is present in the form of the animating spirit in our body. As long as that God's particle is there, the jiva is there, the power of animation is there, the presence that animates and activates the body is there, why are we fearing? Why are we doubting? Everything will be washed off, completely washed off. Maybe tomorrow I may have an occasion to tell you how this happens. So let us not lose hope in our mind. After all, we are a human being. We are not an animal or a bird or a beast. We have got a mind to feel, an intelligence to think, a heart still better for us to melt and be all right in every situation. Tam obayadam pradiyandu vipraha gangaja devi dhrita chittamise dvijopasrishtah kuhakastakshagova dashatvalam gayata vishnugatha. He said, I don't mind having committed this crime. After all, I am very grateful to Sringi, the son of Shamiga Maharshi, for having administered his curse. Only because of the curse he administered, I resolved upon Prayopavesha. What a great opportunity he gave me. Otherwise, my mind would have been vitiated by the remaining part of my life. Thank God I have been given this opportunity. Any number of times I may live in this world, I would like to be a devotee, completely resigning himself to the feet of the Supreme Lord. Tam mopayatam pradiyandu vipraah ganga cha devi dhrita chittamise. All these words are very, very significant. Only when you go into it, you will understand. Mopayatam pradiyandu vipraah. Let all the holy men, the great holy Ganga also, accept me. Accept me despite the slip that occurred in my life, I incurred. Let them all accept me for what I am. Ganga cha devi dhrita chittamise. I have been living all these decades as a king. Now I am a different person. I am no more a king. I am no more a royal member. I am a humble, resigned, surrendered devotee of the Supreme Lord. My mind is firmly, absolutely firmly, unshakably, unassailably, it cannot be dislodged anymore. Dhrita chittamise. In the Supreme Lord, at his feet, my mind is totally fixed. Dvijopasrishtaha kuhakas takshagova. Led by the curse of the Brahmana Kumara, Let Takshaka come and bite me. Deshatvalam Gayata Vishnu Gatha. Are you hearing me? Let Takshaka, ordained by Sringi, come and bite me. It does not matter. It's only going to take place on the seventh day. From now on, this very moment on, Gayata Vishnu Gatha. All of you should narrate and recite Vishnu Gatha. The stories, the exploits, the excellences, the wonderful deeds, acts, etc. The characteral, the behavioral, the interactional, niceties, excellences, magnificences, splendor, etc. of the Supreme Lord. My ears should be feasted throughout the 7 days. This is what I want you to do. I am very happy that you compliment me. I acknowledge your compliments. But this is my simple and humble demand before all of you. Punascha bhuyat bhagavatyanande radih prasangascha tada ashrayeshu mahatsuyam yam upayami srishtim maitryastu sarvasya namo dvijebhyaha. Do you like to hear this? Chup rahte hai na. Hum poochte hai kyun? Do you like to hear? Or it's all an old legend? Is it a living story of the human mind? Or it is a bygone incident somewhere in the past? Punascha bhuyat bhagavatyanande radih prasangascha tada ashrayeshu. Srimad Bhagavata is a scripture which always highlights, upholds, reinforces satsanga, sajjana sangha, satsanga. You are living in your house along with the family members. But mind you, none of them will be able to save you from the stranglehold of mortality, mrityuda. We are called martyaha. What does it mean? We are born only to die. Everyone has died. Our parents are dying, going to die. We are dying every day as we are approaching death day after day. From this mrityu grastada, the stranglehold of mrityu, the parents who have given birth to you will not be able to save you. The husband will not save the wife. The parents will not save the children. Nobody will be able to save. If there is a saving, if there is a salvation, if there is a redemption, it can only be in the hands of great and enlightened people, the tattvajnanis, the maharshis. So he says, punascha bhuyat bhagavatyanande. If I am going to have another birth, let me have anande bhagavati in the infinite Lord ratihi. Let me have fondness, loving interest, loving dedication to him. Prasangascha tada ashrayeshu mahatsu. In the noble and great people, I must have a love for their association, for their loving care, protection, advice, guidance and leadership. I must sit before them and ask them, wherein lies the promotion of human life? What can give me salvation? How can I be relieved from the clutches of mortality? My mind is constantly undergoing pleasure and pain, joy, happiness and misery. Right from the beginning this is going on. When shall I have a relief from it? Is it ever possible? How to administer it? Where from can I get it? Where from shall I proceed? How shall I reinforce it? When shall I have my victory? All these questions can be discussed only with them. Mahatsuyam yam ubayami srishtim maitryastu sarvasya namo dvijebhyaha. I prostrate humbly like a stick before all the people who have assembled here. Let me have maitri. Ceaseless, unceasing fondness for all the creatures in this world. Somehow there was a point of dislike, a moment of dislike in my mind towards that ascetic who was closing his eyes, meditating and remaining absorbed in his hermitage. It was not something wrong. I must have prostrated before him. Maximum I could have waited till he opened his eyes so that he could bless me, he could understand that I was there. Instead of that, what kind of a crime did I do? Let me not do it anymore. I must always have the ceaseless fondness, love, interest and association with all the creatures in this world. Namo Dvijebhyaha. Punascha Bhuyat Bhagavatyanande Radhih Prasangascha Tada Ashrayeshu. You know, the devotees are those people who solely rest upon, rely upon, live upon, completely dedicated to the Lord. There is nothing else for their help, strength or relief. We sannyasins, we are governed by a set of vows. What is that? One is the vow of austerity. Another is the vow of celibacy. The third is the vow of poverty. And beyond everything, the vow of constant reliance upon the supreme, impersonal, impartial God. You may see us moving about. Some sannyasins do great things in this world, which householders cannot do and have not done. Although they are doing all these things, understand that they are doing as a zero, not as a hero, but as a zero. Their mind is a zero, zero. They only rely upon God. That reliance is what sustains them. That is what gives them food, shelter, clothing, every amenity if you find in them, everything is given by them. I always say in our ashram, every particle, every sand particle in the wall, in the floor, everywhere is radiating, radiating the voice and splendor of austerity, I say. We are governed to jnana tapasya, not the tamasic and the rajasic form of austerity, but the jnana tapas. What is the jnana tapas? Vitaraga bhaya krodha manmaya mamupashrita bhagavo jnana tapasa puta madbhava magata. This is the jnana tapas that Sri Krishna clearly defines in the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Looking into your mind and getting away from it, if at all it is present, raga, dvesha and bhaya, desire, hatred and fear. Get rid of these. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to go to the Himalayas. You don't have to go anywhere else. Look into your mind and find out where do these emerge and what for. Do not follow them. Do not pursue them. Do not reinforce them. Do not argue in favor of them. Mahatsuyam yam ubayami drishtim maitryastu sarvasya namo dvijebhya. So Parikshit realizes this. Let me have any number of lives, but in all those lives, I must have an abiding devotion, devotional clinging to the feet of the Lord, and also I must aspire for a constant association with the wise and the enlightened people. I don't mind having any number of births anymore. This is the way we should think. We must have confidence. We must have hope. We must have reliance on God as well as oneself. After all, I have got a sterling mind, a sterling interest, a sterling intelligence, and I have got a very divine and puerile heart. Believe in all these things, and these are the treasures that you have as a human being. He suddenly entrusted the whole kingdom, its administration upon his son, and he walked off. He went to the bank of Ganga, spread kusha grass with tips facing east side, eastward, and he sat on it facing north. Facing north. Now what else? He has 7 days before him, and in the 7 days he wanted to feast his own ears with divine narrations. Ishvara kathas, tattva kathana, either philosophical and spiritual principles, insights, visions, evaluations and the like, or the divine stories and excellences of the Supreme Lord. One or more or both, something. Just like, you see, nature conspired. When he was in the hermitage of Shamika Maharshi, nature conspired and brought a dead cobra there. He took it with the tip of his dhanush, bow, and put it like a garland. The same nature now beautifully conspires to bring a wonderful Shuka Maharshi, 16-year-old ascetic, an absolutely nude boy, before him. Are you hearing me and understanding me? Dekh lijiye na, sun lijiye. The world is full of beauty and splendor. Everything is golden here. Have patience, have tolerance, have the fondness of your heart. Never lose your lens. Everyone is a gem here. Nobody is charcoal. When the whole assembly was impatiently sitting around, Parikshit had already raised his question, Tatra bhavad bhagavan vyasaputro, Tatra bhavad bhagavan vyasaputro, Yadrichayagam atamano anapeksha, Alakshyalingyo yalabhatushto, Vridaschabalaira abhadhutavesha. I am wondering whether I should explain the arrival of Shukamuni and his personality. Do you want to hear it or shall I bypass it? Boliyena. I have got an audience who is very, very mute. Even when I ask them, they don't respond. So I really don't know what to talk. Tatra bhavad bhagavan vyasaputro yadrichaya gam atamano anapeksha. Alakshyalingyo nijalabhatushto vrutascha balair abhadhutaveshaha. There came the 16-year-old Shukamuni. What was he doing? He was floating in the elixir of Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam is a poetic composition. Right from the beginning, it is poetry. Except in the 5th skanda, there is a little prose there. All the others are in poetry of different meters. I recited already a few verses from Srimad Bhagavatam. Janmadyasya yatonvayaditaratashchartheshu abhijnaswarat tene brahma hrida yadikavaye muhyandiyatsurayaha tejo varimrdam yathavinimayo yatratra sargo mrusha dhamna svena sada nirasta guhakam satyam param dhimahi. This is how it began singing. When Shukamuni happened to read and understand the Srimad Bhagavatam, he immediately got attuned to its full taste, delicacy on the one hand, enlightening fulfillment on the other. For him it was a divine intoxication. The devotional nectar, the spiritual elixir, the philosophical delicacy. He found all these in the Srimad Bhagavatam. The moment he started enjoying it, he left everything. Not even an apparel on his body. As an avadhuta, he started. Even the little cloth on the body, he found something irritating and resisting. The whole body was radiating the bliss of the self, the bliss of the self. Our bodies only radiate the heat produced by the self, the bliss we miss. Heat is an energy. Bliss is not an energy, nor is it anything material or chemical. It is something transcendental, something spiritual in character. It can only be felt, it can only be drunk by your heart, not biological heart, by your mind. So when he started the feeling the delicacy of Srimad Bhagavatam, Tatra bhavad bhagavan vyasaputro yadrichaya gam atamano anapekshaha. See, the little boy of 16 years, he had no pull of any desire whatsoever. He found that the success and the glory and the fulfillment of human life lie in non-expectation. Do you like my stating all these things? Or it's away from you? We have expected. Our life is expectant. We have been desiring, hoping. How long? Have you become any better? You have been worshipping a number of decades God. As I told you the first day itself, has God come nearer? Have you gone closer to Him? No, both have not taken place. Then why carry on this worship? Is it not a pseudo-worship? Is it not a hypocrisy? Is it not an ostentation? Why don't you question your own worship? My God is an all-pervading God. He must be pervading and permeating everywhere. So He should be in me. Let me at least search Him in my own heart. If you have taken up such an inner search, would you not have succeeded? I am reminded of Ramakrishna Dev's story. You know, he was a priest by birth and he was carrying on. And Mahakali was the object of his devotion. So he was worshipping. And what was he worshipping? The idol in Dakshineshwar. After all, it was a Kali idol. And as I told you, it is a mute god. It will never speak. It will never react. But he was doing worship, but he was not mute. So one day it occurred to him, am I really worshipping Goddess the Mother, the universal animation, the power of animation? One day he became so dejected, he could not get an answer from the idol. There was a sword lying nearby. He took it and he was about to cut his neck. Suddenly something happened and the sword fell. He had a touch of divine realization and experience that very moment. Is not such an experience possible for every one of you? I am asking you. Boliye na thoda. What did Ramakrishna Dev have additionally in him? He only had a biological body. He had a psychological mind. He had a rational intelligence. He also had an elevated ego. That's all. Nothing more any human being has had or will have. But he put all of them into a state of intensity and fervor. That fervor was what was the factor that brought the result. Suddenly he had a flight of experience. All his questions were answered. All the doubts were totally dispelled. And the purity and the realization, the direct touch and feeling he looked for, suddenly he had. This is what happens to everyone. Tatra bhavad bhagavan vyasa putro yadruchayagam atamano anapekshaha. Anapekshada, that is the pinnacle of devotion. The more and more you become a devotee, the devotion starts attenuating. All your desires, one after the other. Ultimately, you find your mind is completely free of desires. When it becomes anapeksha, in that anapekshata, as Srimad Bhagavatam puts it, nishkinjana mayi anurakta jetasaha shanta mahamdo akhila jiva vatsala kamaihi analabdhadiyo jushandiyadu tan nairabekshyam tad nairabekshyam navidu sukhammama. By devotion you are driven to a state of nairabekshyam, nirabekshada. That nirabekshada itself is called nirvana sukha. When the mind becomes free of all desires, the intelligence is not enveloped by any kind of an aspiration or ambition. You develop a sense of akhila jiva vatsalya, kamaihi analabdhadhiyaha. I am not explaining it in full. Tan nairabekshyam navidu sukham mama. Krishna tells Uddhava, this nirabeksha sukha, how can others understand it or recognize it? That is what this little boy, 16-year-old boy, was radiating wherever he went. Yadruchaya gam atamanaha. Gam means the earth. Atamanaha means rambling upon it. Anapekshaha. Alakshya lingo. On the first look, what do you see? He is a young ascetic, an avadhuta kind. He has no sense of shame. Useless fellow. This is what people will say. Nijalabhatushtaha. Say this word. Nijalabhatushtaha.
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 He has got his own self. And in having had his self, an insight into it, an experience and realization of it, he has become contented, delighted, exhilarating he was. Nothing else was required. This is the description given to God by Prahlada. Naiva atmanah prabhurayam nijalabhapurno manam janat avidushak karuno vrinide. In explaining that, God is never looking for any kind of an honor or a prestige or an adoration from anybody, Prahlada describes Narahari in this manner. Naivatmanah prabhurayam nijalabhapurno. My dear God, people don't know that you are full and contented with your own inner being. You have nothing to get in this world. You are already full. Such a God, what kind of adoration he is going to look for from anybody in this world? So all the worship that people are doing are because of their own delusion, ignorance, delusion, misunderstanding. Am I clear? Or am I confusing you? Any worshipper, has he ever thought what God requires from me? What is God requiring from me? Whatever I do is for myself. Tachatmane pradimukhasya yatha mukhasri. You stand in front of a mirror, look into the reflection and start decorating it, shaving it, etc. Every time you are looking into the mirror, actually the stroke is administered to the reflected face, but it is falling on your face. Similarly, every act of worship, every moment of it, it is to benefit, enrich, empower and elevate you. Not to fatten God at all. Chappanna bhog diya. Isiliye Bhagavan ko kya hoga? Aur bhi sthool ho jayenge kya? Alakshya lingyo nijalabhatushto vrdascha balair avadhuta veshaha. Vrdascha balaihi. Such a boy walking about naked. So all the children found something unusual there. So they became very funny about it. And all of them started surrounding him. A few innocent women also came. For them it was, what is this? After all, the women are the ones who give birth to men also. So they have got an instinct far different from that of men or those of men. So they also came. Tam dvashtya varsham sukumara pada. Karorubahvam sakapola gatram charvayata akshonna satulyakarnam subhruvasanam kambu sujata kandham. Srimad Bhagavata, being a Mahakavya, Paramahamsya Samhita, at the same time it is a Mahakavya, whatever scene it describes with the excellence, best of words. So here is a wonderful 16-year-old boy coming as an avadhuta. Will there be a poet who will ever describe him? An urchin running about. For the normal poets, there will be nothing. See how they are describing. Tam dvashtyavarsham sukumara pada karoru bahvamsa kapola gatram. A human or anything in this world is most beautiful when decorated, or that naisargik sundarada, when is it in the beings, you tell me? Suppose we see a cloud, would you like to decorate it? We see a rainbow, again we will paint it? Boliye na. So what is naisargik beauty? Dvashtavarsham sukumaram. He was very beautiful. Right from the feet, everything is beautiful in him. Sukumara pada karoru bahvamsa kapola gatram. Hands, shoulders, cheeks. The collarbone is well covered. The nose is very high. It is not very beautiful nose, beautiful holes. long eyes, and it is capped by beautiful sparkling eyebrows. The forehead is very wide. On the neck there are 3-4 lines, like a conch, like a shankha. His thighs are good, everything is good. Charu ayata akshonna satulya karna. Both eyes are very much raised and they are symmetrical. If you measure them, millimeter difference will not be there. Generally, every part you will find, though we are symmetrical, the left eye and the right eye are different. The eye specialist will tell you. The power also will be different. And two hands, if you join them, they will not be exactly alike. There will be a difference. But here, symmetrical ears. Subhruvananam kambusujata kandham nigudha jatrum prututunga vakshasam avartanabhim valivalgudaram cha digambaram vaktravigirna kesham pralambabahum swamarottamabham. I don't know whether you like to hear this. अच्छा लगता है क्या? मुझे तो अच्छा लगता है. He has got a broad, well-formed chest. Everywhere the flesh is sufficiently there. Everything is looking very beautiful. Avartanabhim. Normally you have no opportunity to see the navel of anybody. But this boy, the navel is very beautiful. You know, it's quite whirly and circular and sufficiently deep also. In many human beings, because their umbilical cord after cutting is not looked after properly by the mothers and the nurses, you will find it is protruding in most cases. So the best navel will be sufficiently deep. It should be deep. And it will be very beautiful to look at. The most beautiful part perhaps. Avartanabhim vali valgudaram cha. In the abdomen there are beautiful folds and lines. Digambaram. Digambaram. Say that.
Digambaram.
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 Ambara means, other meanings also are there. Here it is ambara means vastra, dress. And what is his vastra? Dik. The 4 or 8 directions. That means he was naked and nude. Digambaram vaktravigirnakesham. Dark blue, dazzling hair. All of them are flowing on all the sides. Not going to a hairdressing saloon. See, it was allowed to flow. Vaktravigirnakesham pralambabahum swamarottamabham. Pralambabahum. His hands were sufficiently long. They were almost touching the knees. That is ajana bahutva. That is considered to be the best lakshana. Shyamam sadapi ichyavayonga lakshmiya. Shyamam sadapi ichyavayonga lakshmiya. Strinam manojnam rujirasmitena. He always had a natural, benign, charming, alluring, enchanting smile. Because he had no problem, agitation, worry or anxiety in his mind. Always smiling. Very, very difficult to see. As children we were smiling. As we grow older and older, our smiles are lost, almost robbed by the world. Shyamam, beautiful Shyamavarna. Sadapichyavayonga lakshmiya. Every part of his body was shining with youthful brilliance. Strinam manojnam. He was very enchanting, particularly to women. Rujirasmidena, with a charming smile. Pratyuthidaste munayaha swasanebhyaha. The moment this boy, Avadhuta boy, came there, there were wise and enlightened people in the assembly. All of them suddenly got up. Pratyuthidaste munayaha. Even the Maharshis, the Tapaswins, the ascetics, all of them got up from their respective seats. Tallakshanajna abhigudhavarchasam. They knew what this youthful, ascetic, naked body really reveals and holds. They could understand. When does a man become an avadhuta? And as an avadhuta, what does a human contain within himself? He becomes an embodiment of benediction. He becomes an embodiment of blessing, benevolence. Very rare are the people who can take to this kind of a life. Normally, as you grow youthful, ambitions grow. Aspirations, they remain enmeshed in your heart. You will lose your sleep. These are Danes, at least mobile will kill you. The moment you become youthful, there is no school boy or girl without a mobile. And when he is in maximum use, after they go to bed. So that the father and the mother, nobody can see. This is what is happening. But he never wanted anything like that. So they understood. Pratyutthitaste munayaswasanebhya tallakshanajna. They could understand veritably what this boy contained in himself and what was the occasion that they were confronting here. Parikshit has already taken to his seat and he was already in the Prayopavesha vow, and he was asking the sages to feast his ears with ceaseless narration of God's stories and excellences, the principles and the practices, the truths, the values, the messages, the siddhantas. And nobody was ready, nobody was equipped. So they found a lot of sudden hope. Sa Vishnurato Adithaya Agataya Tasmai Saparyam Shirasa Ajahara Tadoho Nivritta Ahya Buddhastyo Orbhaga Mahasane Soba Vivesha Pujitaha. When he came, Parikshit had nothing in him. He was not in the palace. He was on a Prayopavesha vow. He had already taken his seat. He got up and prostrated before him. Sa Vishnurato Atithaya Agataya. Actually, he has come there as an uninvited guest. Nobody invited him. The same nature, the same providence which conspired to bring, suddenly hand over a dead cobra to Parikshit. Now the same nature is conspiring in a much more bewitching manner to gift him a 16-year-old youthful Shuka Maharshi. Just imagine. I don't know whether you have the power of imagination. Do you have? Dekh lijiye na kya ho gaya. He came there. Tasmai sabaryam shirasa ajahara. Normally when a king receives a guest, particularly a saint, he will take a golden plate, a golden pitcher. He cannot get golden water, so ordinary water. And with a lot of mantras, tantras, priests and what not, he will go and give him an ovational reception. But poor man, he has nothing in his hand. He's already started becoming weak. He got up. Shirasa ajahara. The reception, the welcome was in the form of a submission, which he indicated by dropping his head right on his feet on the ground. Understand now what is meant by a prostration. Our country is very great, my dear souls. I wish your intelligence is sharp enough, penetrating enough, permeating enough to understand the great legacy that every one of us is incorporating in our body, in our mind, in our heart, and in our soul. A great Maharaja prostrating before an Avadhuta 16 years old. This is the culture of the land. We have got two types of old people. One we call Vayovriddhas, another we call Jnana Vriddhas. Have you heard? Aapne suna hai kya? Vayovriddhas and Jnana Vriddhas. Parikshit is, in terms of physical age, superior and greater. And the young boy, in terms of bodily age, he is younger. But the jnana, knowledge is, he is far superior. So he prostrates, falls at his feet. Shirasa, he gave him the reception. Poor Parikshit, he had nothing else to give. Nothing else to give. Only this. Tato nivritta hya buddha striyor bhaga. When they found that this little boy, whom the children as well as the women had surrounded because of a fancy and a fun, when he goes to the great assembly, Parikshit is seated on a kusha grass facing northward. So many sages are there. All of them got up from the seat and Parikshit falls at his feet. This is not a place for us. All of them left. Tato nivrtahya budhaha striyo arbhagaha. The innocent, non-knowing children as well as the women suddenly left the place. Mahasane so upavishesha upavivesha pujidaha. Shuga was given that seat and he took this seat with a lot of respectful, adoring worship. And he began his narration. I am telling you what Srimad Bhagavatam is. Srimad Bhagavatam is delivering the right message for a person who is going to die bitten by a cobra on the seventh day. It was not a steroid injection. Certainly not. It was not a medical treatment. It was a psycho-intellectual treatment, a feast that was given. Srimad Bhagavata presents devotion on the one hand, knowledge on the other, and thirdly, dispassion, vairagya. So Shuga, before starting his narration, he announces his identity. He first of all says, Chirani kim pathina sandhi dishandhi bhiksham naivangripav parabhrudha saravopya shushyan ruddha guha kimajito vadinopasannan kasmat bhajandi kavayo dhanadurmadandhan. It was almost an indication to King Parikshit. You want me to narrate to you the divine excellences. Mind you, the divine excellences. And the one who is going to do this narration must have a matching divinity, a matching maturity, a matching sublimity and excellence. Don't think that Srimad Bhagavata is a composition which all Toms, Dicks and Harrys can narrate. It is after all a Paramahamsa Samhita, a compendium authored by a Paramahamsa, narrated by a younger Paramahamsa, after hearing which Parikshit became a Paramahamsa at the end on the seventh day. It is such a magnificent text and the message is immortality, immortality, immortality. Srimad Bhagavata has got the power and the majesty, the magnificence to completely alleviate, wipe off, obliterate the threefold affliction and torment the human mind is constantly inflicted with by the perishable world around. This alone has that capacity. Tapatrayonmulanam. Chiranikim pathinasandhi dishandhi bhiksham. What kind of an exponent Srimad Bhagavatam should have? He explains it. Chiranikim pathinasandhi dishandhi bhiksham. Are there not clothes, pieces of cloth, lying strewn on both sides of the road? Can you not collect them, pick them up, stitch them together, and if you want to conceal your privacy, put it on your hip. Are there not strewn pieces of cloth? And what prevents you? Go there, pick them up. The roads are not going to object. The wayfarers are not going to object. Nobody will say anything. It's after all dirty and useless. Everybody wants it to be removed. So you pick them up, stitch them together. If necessary, wash and tie on your hip. Chirani kim pathina sandhi dishandhi bhiksham naivangribhav parabhrudaha. There are a number of trees which bear fruits, leaves, flowers and the like. Anything that you climb or go near, pluck in the manner you want. Eat as much as you like. They will never say, don't touch me. They are called parabhrudaha. They are meant for sustaining and helping and preserving the rest of the community. No tree takes its fruit. No plant eats its leaves. It is all meant for the others. So parabhrudaha, naivangribhav parabhrudaha. Are they not there on both sides of the road? Somewhere in empty or barren grounds also, such trees are growing, uninhabited places. Naivangribhav parabhrudaha saravopya shushyan. Are there not perennial rivers throughout 12 months of the year, 24 hours of the day, they are flowing. Why don't you step down? Take how much water you want, all of it, you take it in your palm and drink. The river is not going to stop. That is a perennial flow arranged by nature. Arranged by nature. Provided by God. Ruddha guha. So the need of food, the need of dress, now the need of shelter. Ruddha guha. Are the mouths of caves in the mountainous regions, are they ever closed? Have they put a door there? Are not all the caves open? They are an open invitation for all of you. Why don't you go and stay there if you want a safe shelter? Ruddha guha. Leave everything. Kim ajito vadino pasannan. Kim ajito vadino pasannan. There is one supreme power, the supreme Lord. He is called Ajita. Until now he is not defeated or conquered by anybody. He is unassailable, always victorious. Has he ever declared that those people who surrender before me and accept me, I am overfull, my storeroom is full, I cannot accommodate anymore, therefore I reject? Has he ever said? Sunte hain kya? Suniye na Bhagavat ki vani. Ki majito vadino basannan. Kasmat bhajanti kavayo dhana durmadandhan. As long as these sources are available and the Supreme Lord Almighty is also ready to welcome you, protect you, insulate you, bestow upon you all kinds of prosperity, favor, fortune, everything, why should you ever mind the blinded rich people of the world? In reading the Shastras or in exposing the Shastras, you should not be frightened by anything. So my dear king, I am an avadhuta. I am seemingly young, but inwardly I am not young. The moment I start opening my mouth, you will find the Srimad Bhagavata composed by Vedavyasa Maharshi personifies itself and comes to you in the form of words. I will never look into your face. I will never look into the surrounding assembly. I will start exposing it like fire is burning anything whatsoever. When the fire is blazing, it never looks to what I am burning. It may burn a dead body. It may burn a costume shop. Anything it burns. Just like fire is hot and blazing, the truthful statements of Srimad Bhagavata should be equally exposed in that manner, without any fear or without any fervor. Why I say this shloka? I like it so much, so much. You know, it tells you how dispassionate the human heart should be, how self-reliant it should be, how unswerving should be its spiritual and philosophical resolve, stand and refuge. Dispassion taken to the zenith. Never depend upon anything. Never grumble for anything. If you want to have a piece of cloth, collect the pieces, stitch and put on. If you want to eat something, go to the forest, pluck the fruits and eat like monkeys. They are also living. We can also live. We don't have to wash our teeth even. Monkeys are washing the teeth. Are they washing the teeth? It is the cooked food that spoils the gum and the feet and the teeth. If you start eating raw things, washing will automatically take place. So ultimately there is a God to protect you. Be completely sure of His mercy, of His power, of His readiness. Never bow before anybody at all. Carry Srimad Bhagavatam in your heart. Install God in your heart. Be radiant, be abundant, be affluent, be superbly rich and resourceful. Never speak from a weak platform of your mind. Speak from towering strength. Towering strength. Speak from an unconquerable position, unassailable position. After all, you are speaking about God. You are speaking about the soul, the imperishable, the imperishable, the immortal, the great, the most high. The person should have this kind of an ascetic dimension, he says. I don't know whether you like this. Boliye na thoda. I'm always talking in front of a crowd which I cannot see. Here at least the people are there, so I'm asking you. I will recite it once again and stop. चीराणि किं पथिन सन्धि दिशन्ति भिक्षां नैवाङ्घ्रिपाः परभृतः सर्वोऽप्यशुष्यन् रुद्धा गुहा किमजितोऽवति नोपसन्नान् कस्माद् भजन्ति कवयो धनदुर्मदान्धान् द लास्ट् वर्ड् इस् धन दुर्मदान्धान् because they have a few crores of rupees, they feel the entire world is behind them. What is that? Shukamini personifies the real exponent of Srimad Bhagavatam. Whenever we discuss Srimad Bhagavata, become like that. This is the standard set for an exponent. The exposition should be so pure, so sharp, so sweeping. And Srimad Bhagavata does so. Parikshit is given a signal. This is the type of narration that you can expect from me. Yes. This is the book called Vedantic Way of Living. It's a very small book, but it's a very good and a beautiful, precise introduction to the entire Vedanta as a subject and Vedantic living as a pursuit. Many people do not know that Vedanta is the right way of living. So it contains actually 7 lectures I gave many years back in Chennai, Madras. And it runs like this: Vedantic way of living, what is life, what is karma yoga, the science of work, what is bhakti yoga, the science of devotion, jnana yoga, the science of knowledge, meditation and life, the right way of living. Vedanta should be actually the right way of your living. Many people are religious, some are devotional. But I don't think most of you or super majority are not spiritual in your lifestyle. In religion, we always look to an external God and that too invisible God at infinite distance. When it becomes spiritual life, the whole life is based upon your own personality, the 4 levels of it. What are the 4 levels? The sensory and the bodily level. Then the aural level. These 2 are visible. The other 2 are inward, inner, mental level and intelligential or intellectual level. These are the 4 levels in which your practice should be sufficiently centered. It is not necessary for us to address anything to a distant product or an invisible source. We must be able to embody our religious and spiritual spirit and refinement in our own life. Can it be done? If so, how? And what is the way? This is what this book clearly speaks. So it can be a very good book provided you read it and understand it. We generally have karma yoga, bhakti yoga, jnana yoga, raja yoga, etc. These are yogas so much spoken about. What are they? That also clearly explained here in a very brief manner. Tomorrow I propose to discuss a very important subject of devotion. Our subject is from the distant God to the inmost self. So tomorrow I will cover this subject and make it fully so. I am going to take you to a conversation that Narada Maharshi had with Vasudeva, Krishna's father. What? Vasudeva? Krishna's father. Vasudeva was saying, I have lost something very great. Though I have got Krishna as my son, I have lost everything in my life. I am nowhere. I am a directionless boat in the endless sea. My fate is very miserable. My dear sage, will you try to give me something whereby I can fulfill my life? This was the conversation. So Narada says, there was a similar event transpired earlier. I am reminded of it. Bhagavata Dharmas. What? Bhagavata Dharmas. I will explain to you what is meant by the characteristics and the behavioral pattern of devotees, Bhagavata Dharmas, by virtue of which God will give you his own very self. What? So you can host God in your own body, within your heart. So we are going to have a taste of what are these Bhagavata Dharmas tomorrow. Come prepared for that. So it's a feast, so you can bring as many people as you want. Harihi, Harihi. സംവേദ്യവർജിതമനുത്തമമേകമാദ്യം സംവിത്പദം വികലനം കലയൻ മഹാത്മൻ ഹൃദ്യേവതിഷ്ഠകലനാരഹിതക്രിയാം തൂ കുർവൻ അകർത്തൃപദമേത്യ ശമോദിതശ്രീ കുർവൻ അകർത്തൃപദമേത്യ ശമോദിതശ്രീ ഹരി ഹരി ഹരി. വി ഷാൽ ഹാവ് ദ കൺക്ലൂഡിംഗ് റിസൈറ്റേഷൻ ഓഫ് ഓം. ടേക്ക് യുവർ പോസ് ഫോർ ഇറ്റ്. ഹരി ഓം. തത്സ ജയഗുരു.